Welcome, friends. I am very happy to make another visit to Florida to meet you. And it's always a great joy and pleasure for me to meet people who are traveling on the same path that I am doing. We are all going towards our spiritual destination, which we believe is our true home. This seeking for a true home comes to us when we feel that the present situation in which we are living is not the kind of life that we would actually like to have. When we get fed up of the life we are leading, we begin to seek something which we believe will be our true home. This seeking is something internal in us. Sometimes we do not know where this seeking is coming from. We try to convert our seeking into searching. We search with our minds, but we seek with something more internal to us. Sometimes we call it our soul. Sometimes we call it our real life that is inside us, something deep within us that is so deep that sometimes we can't even connect it with our thoughts. Our thoughts come from our mind. But we convert our seeking into searching, and then we start searching outside. Because the mind always wants to find answers to its questions from outside. We go all over to different conferences, libraries, books, ashrams, gurus, masters. We are constantly going outside to find answers to a seeking that is going on within our own self. Searching does not give us the true answers to our seeking. In fact, sometimes the searching confuses us more than what we were in before we started searching. Because during our search with our mind, we find there are so many contradictions. People tell us very different things at different places. And we are left confused. Where is the truth? Some people say the truth has to be found within yourself. Our religions speak about it. Our first attempt to find something beyond this world is to look through religion. Our religion teaches us that the truth lies within ourselves. So we must find it within ourselves. We are told the kingdom of God is within ourselves. We are told the truth of our own being is within ourselves. We ourselves feel that whatever our self is within ourselves, not outside. It appears to be within not only ourself, within ourself as we see today, as a body, as a human body. The human body seems to be containing the self. Then why are we running outside all the time? If the truth lies inside, why do we go outside? If we want to find an answer to this very basic question, that we all know the truth is inside, why are we running outside? Running far off places to search for truth. Some people have left their homes and gone into forests. Some have gone into high mountains. Some have gone into ashrams lying far away. Some have left their countries to go to other countries to find the truth. When all the time we are told that the truth is lying inside your own body, which you are moving all around to find the truth. They give the example of the musk deer who has a smell of the musk coming from inside. He does not know, the deer does not know where it's coming from. Runs all over the forest, gets tired and falls down, tired. Not knowing where this smell is coming from, the smell is coming from within itself. We have our awareness of the self from within ourselves. We are even trying to find our true self outside of ourselves. How can that happen? Why don't we go within and find the truth? The answer, of course, again is simple. We do not know how to go within. We do not know what is within. We have no idea what is within. Within the body? It's just a biological feature. It's an anatomy. If you look at the anatomy of the body, it's a wonderful machine. A wonderful machine, and we know that a bulk of the decision making in the machine is taking place in the head, in the brain. That's all we know. Brain is just a clump of gray matter, but we do not know anything more than that. But when we are talking of the ultimate self, obviously we are talking of something more than this body. We are talking of something that is making us alive and conscious and aware, which is giving us the power to see the world, to think for ourselves, to imagine things. These are wonderful opportunities that we can look out with our eyes, touch the world with our hands, smell with our nose, have all the five senses to experience this world with this body. It's wonderful to have sense perceptions which has give us an idea of an external experience that is going on, into which we are running to find answers to how the experience is being generated. We want to know what's the secret of creation of this universe. Also, some very fundamental questions. Why are we here? Why are we born as human beings? Is there a purpose to life, or just a random appearance in a series of experiences in which we find there are many others experiencing the same world like us? Millions, billions of people around us on this planet, one small planet. We don't know how many planets there are carrying populations like ourselves. So where are we looking for? Then religion tells us, you have to believe. You have to believe something in order to satisfy these questions. You cannot find the answers in a simple way, in the way we find answers to other questions. Here you have to believe something. You have to believe there is a God. You have to believe there is a creator. And since you have to find the truth within yourself, you have to find the God within yourself. So far, so good. But then the question is, if God is within ourselves and we have to ourselves find God within ourselves, is there any role that an outside person can perform in it? We talk of masters, gurus, teachers, guides. What is their role if our whole path to God realization, to discover the truth of ourselves, is all within ourselves? Do we need an agent outside for a travel to our own kingdom of God? Are these gurus and all merely agents that were sitting outside? These are very basic questions. If God is within us, we should be able to find God without any agent outside. The only thing required is that we should know how to go within. If we do not know how to go within, there could be a case made out that you could find from somebody who says, I can tell you how to go within, and then get that guidance. That is legitimate, to get some guidance, because when we say go within, what do we mean by it? We should close our eyes. Otherwise, we're looking outside. If we close our eyes, maybe we will be able to look something inside. When we close our eyes, it is dark, because the light with which we were seeing outside is blocked with our eyelids. We can't see. So we open our eyes and see the world again. We close our eyes and see nothing. Therefore, we give up. But there is something we can see even with our eyes closed. Now that's the most important point I want to bring to your attention. That if you close your eyes while you are looking outside, you will stop seeing what is outside. It will be dark. But if you close your eyes and use something else, not trying to see anything, but try to imagine something. When you imagine something, you begin to see. Isn't that remarkable that we can imagine anything and then we can start seeing with our eyes closed? Not only with eyes closed, we can sit in a completely dark room with no light at all and close our eyes and imagine we are remembering a friend of ours whom we met yesterday, and we can see the face of that friend in front of us. Obviously, these eyes are closed. Obviously, there is no light. How are we looking at the friend's face with our eyes closed in darkness? Are those eyes that are looking at it? Certainly not these eyes. These are closed. Do we have some other eyes that we can use when we imagine something in utter darkness? Are there another set of eyes we have? And are we the same being who are imagining and seeing things, the same person, the same being, the same self who are seeing outside, or is there somebody different? Very interesting point. I am only talking of seeing with eyes of imagination, with these eyes closed. Can we do other things also with other sense perceptions? Can we, for example, see flowers? We can see these flowers outside. Can we see, imagine flowers inside? Just imagine. Can we smell them? Can we have the fragrance of the flowers? If you try, you will find all of us can smell the flowers, with no flowers existing at all, except in our imagination. Can we touch them? Yes, we can. Can we taste food by imagination? Yes, we can. The whole point I am making is, does imagination give us an experience of other eyes, other hands, other ears, other taste, mouth? All five senses are intact inside through imagination. Whose eyes are those? Whose ears are those that we can imagine we are hearing things, we can imagine we are seeing things? Why am I emphasizing this point is because our whole idea of what is real in this world is based upon these five senses. If I want to say, is this table real sitting next to me? I can say, yes, I can see it, I can touch it. I use a second sense perception and I can say it is real because I use my sense perception. Or I can, is this water real? I can take a sip of it, it tastes good, it is real. Do we have any other means of finding the reality of this universe other than our sense perceptions? Deep question. Do we know what is real in what we are experiencing in any way other than through our five sense perceptions? The answer comes no. A very strange answer, that all our definition of reality of our experiences is entirely 100% based upon our sense perceptions. Just because we have five of them, we use one against the other to establish the level of reality. If we could only see this world, but not smell it, touch it, or taste it, it would be doubtful. Maybe we are just seeing a picture, maybe it's imagination, maybe it's not real. But then we touch things, then we smell things, then we use other sense perceptions. And therefore it's real. Well, if that is so, when I imagine something, I can also see it, I can also touch it, I can also smell it, I can also taste it. Why does it not look real? It still looks imaginary. If the sense perceptions are creating my reality, then when I close my eyes and imagine things, that should also look real. It looks unreal because I'm imagining it. Now supposing I altogether forget the reality outside. Completely. Which we all do every day when we go to sleep. When we go to sleep, we are unaware of our body. We are unaware of our eyes, unaware of all the sense perceptions. And then in the middle of the sleep, we have a dream. While the dream is taking place, we can see things, touch them, and we use the same things which we are doing now to establish it is real, the dream is real. When does the dream become unreal? When we wake up in the morning and say, oh, it was only a dream. The body is still here. In the dream, we thought we are going somewhere, running far away, but when we wake up, we get nowhere. We are still in the same bed, sleeping in the same bed. What is it that turns away the reality that during dream we feel real? I can tell you with certainty, if you saw me in a dream talking to you, and I said, is this table real? And I said, is I can touch it is real, you will believe everything you are seeing is real, just like you are believing now it's real. But if you are awake, you will not believe it. It becomes imaginary. If you are awake and then seeing things at the same time, then you also know your awareness is that you are awake in this body and you are sitting on a chair, you are imagining things which are not the same as what you are experiencing here. They look imaginary. When you go to sleep, you are not aware of your body. If you were aware of your body and had a dream, it's called a daydreaming, never real. Daydreaming is never real. Real dream is real. I can apply the same test in a dream. In a dream, I say, is this real? I touch it. Is the water real? I taste it. Same things. And we say it's real. In the dream, sometimes we come to know it's a dream. Strange feeling comes. It's a dream. What do? We tell the people around us, do you know it's a dream? The body that is telling people it's a dream, is that real? Is it ourself? It is ourself. Because when we wake up, we discover, you say, I told people in the dream it was real. That means the body you took in the dream was still your body. But you're not this body. This was sleeping. Do you have two bodies? One you use in your dreams and one you use when you're awake? Do you have three bodies? One you use in your dream, one when you're awake and one when you're imagining? When you imagine, supposing we were to close our eyes and imagine we are flying in the sky. Everybody can do that. It's imaginary. We close our eyes and we say we are imagining we are flying in the sky. That's a body flying in the sky. We can even see the sky, the blue sky with the clouds. We are imagining those things. Is that a third body we have? How many bodies do we have that we are using it constantly without realizing that we are focusing only on one body, which we say is a physical body with this anatomy, is real? Dream is not real. Imagination is not real. But it's the same self that is using all the three bodies. And they are not one body, they are three. Distinctly three. In the dream, you go far away. You are not where you are sleeping on the bed. You're dreaming, you're walking far away, experiences far away, meeting people far away, doing things far away. And even discovering it's a dream, you're still far away from where you are sleeping. You have no idea when you say it's a dream, no idea that you're lying in a bed. You're talking as if that's a real person and it's yourself. The most amazing thing is that no matter how many bodies you create, the self is still the same. There is one common factor in all these the self is still the same. Can we make any use of this information? I say a lot of use can be made to discover the nature of the self. The first thing known is the self can have several bodies. And the reality of each body is created by the sense perceptions of that body. Simple truth. We are creating the reality of physical world from the sense perceptions of a physical body. We create the reality of a dream by the sense perceptions of the dream body. We create the reality of the imaginary self with the sense perceptions of the imaginary body. Imagine the role our sense perceptions are playing. And imagine they are not connected with this body at all. When we use eyes to see something in a dream, these eyes, they have some connection. What? The eyes are moving rapidly. Rapid eye movement is taking place in this body. And we are running around all over the world in the other body. I remember in 1962, when I first came to the United States, the subject of dreams and sleep was a very interesting subject being studied by a lot of institutions. Even some universities were going into it. But there was one institution called the Sleep Institute. I joined them just to understand what have they found about sleep and dreams. Why do we dream? Are dreams taking us to another dimension of life, or are we just creating it from our own subjective self? What is the nature of dream? So it was very interesting to see how they used to put subjects to sleep, put cameras on them, and all the EKG stuff on them, so that their measurement of the vital forces, what they are seeing in the dreams, are they creating effect upon this body? Those are the studies going on. And it was a surprising experience to find that we all dream several times every night. And 90% of us don't remember the dreams at all. 90% of us say we never dream. Or rarely we dream, we remember once in a while. And there we found every subject that came in was every few minutes dreaming. A dream was not lasting more than 12 minutes. Sometimes 3 minutes, 5 minutes, 12 minutes, person would shake and go into deep sleep. After some time, dream again, the eyes would start flutter. The way we could know a person is having a dream is because every time the eyes were moving rapidly, the eyelids were moving rapidly, we could wake up the person, say, "What are you seeing?" And they would tell us the dream. And we used to interrupt their sleep just to find out what dream they are having. And the eyelids were moving rapidly up and down. So we woke up the person. "What are you seeing?" "Oh, I'm seeing a waterfall." Now the waterfall is a vertical experience and the eyes are moving vertically. Another person's eyes are moving horizontally. We wake him up. "What are you watching?" "Oh, I was watching a tennis match." That means what they are experiencing, sensory perception inside, is being shown on the physical body somehow. But just by seeing that, we could not know what they are dreaming. We had to wake them up to find out what they are seeing. The most amazing thing we found was that the descriptions they gave of their dream had no relation with the time it took to dream. In one case, I remember, one person, we woke up and we said, "What were you dreaming?" Because his eyes fluttered in different directions at different moments. So we knew it's a very complex dream going on. So when we woke up that person and said, "What were you seeing?" He said, "I was remembering my childhood, and I remember why I was going to school. I was carrying my books with me. And there I met a girl whom I liked very much. She was my sweetheart. Then I remember we got married in a church, and I still remember the whole marriage ceremony. Then I remember we got kids, and I still remember all my kids. Then I grew old. Then one of my kids got married, and I became a grandpa. And then you woke me up. All this happened in 3 minutes. His whole life he lived, and we woke him up in 3 minutes when the fluttering started. And we found so many cases, people described a life of several years dreamt, and actually it took only 7 minutes. So it was very interesting to see that the time that we experience in another alternate state, in a dream state, is not the same that we experience here. Do we also alter the time when we go into an imaginative state? That's a good experimentation to do. If we imagine we are there, do we also alter the time? Yes, experimenters have shown, if you can imagine deeply, now that's the key word, not merely imagine. Because when you merely imagine, it is like a daydream. In daydream, you never feel that that's real, you. You always feel this body is real, I'm thinking of something else. And imagination, while you're still thinking of this body, is not real, it's imaginary. What is the meaning of deep imagination? Let us say, we imagine so much at such a place in our body, which helps us to become unaware. Unlike going to sleep, when we are automatically tired and the body needs rest, and the cycle, biorhythmic cycle has been set up, that we automatically feel like going to sleep and we go to sleep. In imagination, there nothing has been set up. Can we create a biorhythm of our own? Can we create a rhythm by which we can imagine something to the extent that we become unaware of this body like we do in a dream? Can we do that? Yes, the experimenters have said it can be done. And what is the method? Now I'll tell you the method of going into an imaginative state and go into that state while becoming unaware of this physical body. Then you see what happens. How do you do it? First say, where do you imagine anything? Then we want to close our eyes. Where are we imagining things from? Are we imagining in our hands? No. Legs, feet? No. Torso? No. Heart? No, not really. We are imagining behind the eyes, always. Whenever we close our eyes and imagine something, we are imagining it in front of these eyes. Nowhere else. Okay, let us say that the imaginary point from where we actually imagine anything is behind the eyes. And we close our eyes and we imagine we are there. Not in this body. We are there in our imaginary body. With imaginary hands, we close our eyes, and with these hands down below, we imagine we have raised our hand and have touched our eyes. We can do that. Anybody can do that. That we just imagine that these hands are down below, but in my imagination, I am sitting there and I put my hands on my eyes. I can wave my hand, I can look at my hands. Now, if you can do that imaginary thing, then you can also think, can I speak there? Yes, you can speak. Can you hear what you are speaking? Yes. Can you imagine you have a friend there and you're talking to that friend? Of course you can. Let's imagine that you are sitting behind the eyes and imagining having conversation with somebody. What will happen? If the conversation is really interesting and you get involved in it, and if your conversation leads to an argument and you want to prove your point to your friend, and if you are going to fight with your friend, do you know what will happen? If you try this imaginative exercise, you will be exchanging blows with your inner hands, and these hands will just move a little bit outside, and you will not even know you have these hands at the same time as you are having that. What are you really doing? What you are doing by trying to imagine something is to put your attention on your imaginative self. That's all. Supposing we understand this is what is happening, that we are putting our attention on our imaginary self. And we are creating more activity. So more attention is drawn there. The obvious result will be, we will gradually don't know where the outside body of ours is. We won't know where the hands and feet have gone. We won't know where the legs have gone. We won't know the torso have gone. We will begin to believe that is ourself. If we can lose complete awareness of the physical body by this imaginative exercise, something very strange happens. I know nobody had done it. It's a deep exercise. It's called deep imagination. Deep imagination is all your activities that you do with your physical senses, with your thoughts, with your ideas, they're all being done there with the imaginative self. If you do that and you become unaware of this body, you will find that the imaginative body that you found was actually more real. The sense perceptions are far better than you ever had on this body. Not only that, the biggest thing that happens is that you can start remembering what you did yesterday with that self, what you did last week, not with this body, with the inner self that's all started off with imagination. You can even remember what you did 100 years ago. Your imagination is really creating a memory of yours that happened 100 years ago. Are you feeling that your imaginary body can remember something that happened before this body was born? Is it possible? If you do this experiment, you'll find it is possible. I think it's a very great discovery that you have the chance now to use the same method of determining reality, which you are determining in the physical world, which you are determining in the dream world, and the same thing you are determining in the imaginative world, and find out that the imaginative self has a longer history than either the dream body or the physical body. First time a new idea comes to you, then you do that. Maybe what I am now experiencing is not imaginary. Then why did it look imaginary? Is there any real good reason why something that should have a memory and a history longer than this physical body should look imaginary? And I tell you, the reason for looking imaginary is only, it looks imaginary only while you still have the awareness of this physical body. And till you are convinced the physical body is the only reality. So long as that is there, it's imaginary. The moment the awareness of physical body goes away, no matter what kind of imagination you are using, that becomes a reality. The sense perceptions you are using are the same sense perceptions you use here. Is there a difference? Can you define a difference in this physical body and the use of sense perceptions and the imaginative body using sense perceptions? The only difference I can see is this body has matter, molecules, atoms, physical matter. It is physical with matter. And that imaginative self has no matter at all. Does it have everything else that this body has? Sense perceptions, definitely. Mind, thinking mind, is still there? Absolutely. You can be thinking in the imaginative self as well as you think from here. Life, are you alive there? Of course you are as alive as this, if not more. Do you have a soul there? If soul is giving life, of course. That means soul, mind, sense perceptions, all intact exactly as they are with the physical body, only matter missing. What is the use of doing this experiment? I am suggesting a deep imaginative experience, which I can also call deep meditation experience. When we say meditation, people are giving so many different connotations of the word meditation. What do we meditate upon? I went to a meditation school in the 60s. They said meditation is upon a music we will play. And the music has been prepared from the waves of the ocean and from birds chirping in the forest and all natural sources. It was a very beautiful music, very soothing, put me to sleep. It is good. The meditation was good to go to sleep peacefully. Very charming music. But I was meditating on something I was hearing with my ears. It had nothing to do with meditating on my own self at all. No matter what my self is, I was using the ears of a physical body to meditate on the music. Then they said, you should meditate on an image. The best is to have a picture of somebody, a god, or preferably a goddess. We have choices in India of gods and goddesses. If you like the beautiful picture, beautiful woman dressed up like a goddess, it's easier probably for a man to think of it. You meditate on that picture. I closed my eyes, I thought of the picture, then I thought of many other girls I knew. That's very easy. My memory went back to physical experiences. We are still calling it meditation. Meditation merely means putting attention on something. What about putting attention on your own self? If you want to find a god or goddess, you can put attention on a god or goddess. But what if you want to find out who you are? Who are you who can still be the same self in a dream? Who are you who is still the same self in the physical body? Who are you who is still the same in an imaginative self? How can the self be the same and everything else is changing? Form is changing, experience is changing, everything is changing. Self is not changing. Why not look for that? Why not meditate on the self? How is it possible to do meditation on the self? Well, think of the self. Put attention on the self. Wherever you think the self is, if you want to find more than what is the body, the next best step is to find out how you can have an imaginative sense perceptions, also creating the same reality. If you meditate upon the self, that is, looking at things, listening to things, touching things in imagination, if you put your attention on your own self there, then what happens? Exactly what I described earlier. Deep meditation, deep imagination, no different. It's just putting attention on yourself. Who are you? It's a wonderful experience to discover that what we think are sense perceptions are not of the body at all. But they are sense perceptions of our power to imagine, of a power to have a feeling that we can generate a self of ours through a conscious effort, which we call imagination. So supposing you begin to imagine that you are really where you believe you are thinking from, say behind the eyes. Why do they say it's easy for that? Because when we close our eyes, we're still behind the eyes. We're still looking out from the same spot. In fact, I have been mentioning in the last few talks I've given that we are never seeing the world even outside from these two eyes. Because these two eyes see two different pictures and we are seeing one picture. These two eyes are seeing two different people and we are seeing one. If we put our finger in front of us and look at a distance, we see two fingers. One is stronger than the other. Why? Because two eyes cannot see the same thing. There's no way. They are placed separately. When we look at this world, we are not looking through the eyes at all. But when we close our eyes, we don't see. Therefore, we believe we see through the eyes. But since the two eyes are seeing two different pictures, where are we combining them? I know filmmakers have done a good trick. They produced 3D movies. They say the eyes see two pictures. Therefore, they take two different movies with two cameras as apart from each other as the eyes. Then they show both the pictures on the screen. If you see the screen with your open eyes, there are two pictures overlapping each other. Then they give you glasses to wear. And the glasses are separating the two images. One can see one image, the other can see the other. Either by old time they used to see green and red colors. Now they use Polaroid differences. So Polaroid makes each eye looking at a different picture on the screen. And we combine. And when we combine, we create a distance, a depth. And things that are on the screen look like they have come real near us. Very interesting feature. That the power to combine two different pictures, two eyes are seeing, generates depth of distance, depth of space. If you understand carefully, you will see that the two eyes, when they're combining into one without glasses, are they looking at one world or two? They're looking at two worlds, combining and making one world in space. That's the function of the eyes. The eyes are merely carrying the reflection of something on the retina, two pictures on the retina, two pictures being carried to the optic nerve, but inside the head, the two pictures are combining. Where exactly are they combining? In the head. It's not happening outside at all. The two pictures the eyes are seeing are becoming one inside the head. If you examine where am I seeing the world from in depth, you will notice it is not in the eye, behind the eyes. How far behind? If you carefully examine where do I see the world from with these two eyes and make it one in depth, you will find it's further back. It's as far back as the two ears. It's experimentation. If you look at the brain and how the optic area is designed, they are all designed in a way to bring you to the center behind the eyes to be able to say, I am seeing. Well, this is just one sense perception, but the very major one. What about ears? Why do we have two ears? Two eyes to create space, two ears placed differently on different sides of the head. So they cannot hear equally the sound coming from anywhere. One is closer, one is further. Thereby determining direction. Space and direction are being created merely by the placement of these objects, which we call eyes and ears on this body. What about the other sense perceptions? What about smell? Nose right next to it. Drawing it inside again to the same level. Taste in the mouth. The most sensitive tactile place being the tongue and the lips. Can you imagine all these five senses are concentrated in a small part of this body? It makes it easy to understand that if perception is leading to our idea of reality and the five senses are being used to determine reality, they are placed all so close within a small part of this body. If you have to investigate where they are, this is the area to investigate. If you want to put attention on yourself, put attention where you hear, where you smell, where you do these things, starting from the body. It automatically brings you into the area of the head, uniquely behind the eyes, between the ears, which is sometimes called the third eye. Third eye center, center of consciousness, center of awareness, center of from where we are creating a reality of our experiences outside. Center of where we believe we are operating from. If we said we are a notional point of awareness, not a body, but we are running the body from inside, where are we running it from? You examine this, try the whole body, every part you'll find it's exactly the same spot we call third eye center, right behind these eyes, between the ears. In the anatomy of the brain, anatomy of the head, you'll find that place also is considered very important. There is a pituitary body there, there's a pineal gland there on the side of it, there's a medulla oblongata hanging, that's right in the center, exactly where I'm pointing out, in anatomy of the brain. But is that the place from where we are feeling we are alive and conscious? I remember when I was working for the government of India, a VIP, a head of state of another country came to visit us. And he had a car accident. And he got into coma. We were very worried that a foreign dignitary has had an accident in our country. And we didn't want him to die. We said we'll get the best doctors from the world. Because he was in a state of coma. That means unconscious. We tried to bring the best surgeons, brain surgeons from all over the world. And I remember one brain surgeon came. He had operated 1,000 brains. And my boss, who was the chief minister of the state, he asked him, "Doctor, tell me, what makes a person conscious? This guy has become unconscious, he's in a coma. What makes one conscious?" Doctor said, "Sir, this question is being asked for thousands of years. We have no answer. What makes us alive? What is life? We have no idea. One thing we know, as a brain surgeon, I can tell you, that we have laser equipment today that we can activate or deactivate certain functions of the senses by putting the laser. If we put the laser at the center of the brain, same point we call third eye center, a person becomes unconscious. We know that the center has something to do with our being conscious and alive, but we do not know what it is. But the point was, here everything is pointing out that if we are self other than the body, which is making the body alive, it is operating from some point behind the eyes, between the ears. Can we then take advantage of this information and say, if we want to meditate upon the self, we start imagining we are at that point. Simple. If we imagine we are at that point, what would happen? I don't know how many of you have tried it. I've tried it. And I met a lot of friends who also tried it with me. In order to imagine we are there, a simple trick is to first discard the idea you are a body. Instead of calling it your body, call it your house in which you live. Mobile home. Mobile home in which you are living. And the mobile home has some attachments like legs and arms. Basically, it's the torso of the body. It has 6 floors. How do we determine the floors? Because there are certain chakras, the energy centers in the body, starting from the rectum, the genital, the navel, the heart, the throat, and the eyes. These energy centers have been determined through yogic practices for years that they operate to create certain circuits of energy to move around. Each of them are really responsible for our having the life experience in a body and outside contact with the world. Let us say this is a house and these centers represent the levels, the floors of the house. When we are awake, we are looking at this outside from the house, the windows in front called our eyes. Sixth floor. This will be our sixth floor. According to energy centers, eyes are where the sixth floor is, the sixth center is. Let's say we are living in a house with six floors. We are right now at the sixth floor behind the eyes and we are sitting in that little chamber. We close our eyes, we create a nice chamber. We are in that imaginative chamber and we can feel that the physical eyes, which are our windows now, are right in front. And the ears, which are like some kind of hearing aids we have, are on either side of us. If we find that no, the ears are too far behind, we move back in our imagination. If we find no, the ears are in front now, we move forward. We locate ourselves exactly between the ears, behind the eyes. What would happen? Now put attention on your imaginative self and do all the things I was saying earlier. You will be surprised just by doing that exercise. You will make that inner self consisting of sense perceptions, same mind, same thoughts, same soul, same life alive. As you will notice, it was that life that was making this life workable. We are alive in this body because of the life of the inner self. That has sometimes been called the astral self. This body has been called physical self, a sthul sharir, made of matter. And that body which we are merely using imagination to get it is called suksham sharir, astral self. The word astral is used because just like we see a sky out here, our whole concept of the world is it's huge with a sky on top. When we close our eyes, our imagination creates a different sky. But that sky is not like this one. In this sky, we have night and day. The hours are creating different light. The light that is existing outside in this physical sky is different. The inner sky always have a twilight zone. Always we can see things in there, no matter how dark, no matter how light. Therefore, the sky is different. Therefore, we say it's an astral self. What can the astral self do? It can use, it can think, like we think here. It is alive, it has a soul. It can do things this body cannot do, such as fly. It can drop itself from the top of the building and not get hurt. This one gets hurt. It can fly at high speed. This body cannot even fly in an aeroplane at the speed at which your imaginative self can fly. When it flies, what does it see? I don't know how many of you have done this meditation to see how far the astral self can fly. You will notice it can fly over this world, in this sky. It can also fly in a higher sky, which is different from this world. You discover the sky contains a lot of different things just in that self. Is it then imagination that we're creating all that? Is it possible? The two things that come up that we cannot even imagine things that you will see. You will try to imagine one thing and you see something different. Because it's not imagination. It also comes out like we are seeing something here. During these meditation exercises I do in various places, I tell a simple thing. During meditation, in the imaginative self, pick up a mirror. When you pick up a mirror here, you see the same face every time. Can you try this tonight? When you are in half asleep, just try to imagine you are there and pick up a mirror and see your face. Every person that I have tried in that state sees a different face. Girls can see men's faces. Men can see girls' faces. The face keeps changing while they are watching it. Different faces appear. You are not trying to imagine that. Then what has happened? Where has imagination failed and something else has taken its place? First time you will find that imagination is only leading you to a state of experience, state of being that is far more real. Imagination was merely a trick to withdraw your attention from this self in order to discover your inner self, which is having a totally different experience. I even give simple experiments to people, even with little imagination. I say, imagine that you are looking at these flowers. When they imagine, different flowers come up. The flowers change colors while they're imagining them. They're not trying to imagine different colors. I people tell them, imagine that you are gone on top of the roof and a gift is waiting for you. And they imagine the gift they get are totally the one they never imagined. Where is this coming from? What we're trying to do is something different. What's happening is different because it is something different. The discovery that you have an inner self, which is more real, which has a longer memory, the big discovery that this body is very temporary housing for you. That the one that you are achieving through this exercise is more real. And when we say a person dies, we can now be sure after our own experience that body will not die. Therefore, there is something living longer than this physical body, and we can achieve it with a simple meditation on your own self. What is the value of doing it? Is this meditation any usefulness? Does it have any usefulness in this life, which we are taking as real? The usefulness is one big fear people have, fear of death, that disappears. There are some other usefulnesses also. I'll explain them to you. I think when I can get a chance to talk to you again, I'll break now for lunch. But there are several other usefulnesses that you get by having the experience of your inner self, starting with imagination, discovering that not imaginary body, and what is the use of having that experience even for 5 minutes a day while you're sitting in this life, in this body? What is the usefulness of that in this life? I'll explain that to you after we come back. I'll talk to you again for a little while after lunch. Thank you very much for very patiently listening to me. We'll break for lunch now.